Just about 7 or 8 days ago, while I was entering in the great city of Konya, Turkey, and the great shrine of Mevlana Rumi, Jalaluddin Rumi, and I read a couplet, and I want to dedicate whatever I'll say today to Mevlana Jalaluddin Rumi and to his couplet. I'll start with that because it is very closely linked to my whole theme for today's discussion, which is about role of education, knowledge, pluralism, and encouraging religious harmony. So let me start with that couplet. I have a couple of pictures from this last week's visit to Konya. Hopefully one of those will come up very shortly. The main couplet that is in my mind is, and I'll start with that, it says, come, come again. Whatever you are, whether you are an infidel, whether you are an idolater or a fire worshipper, whether you have broken your vows 100 times, whether you have broken your vows of repentance 100 times, this is not a caravan of despair. This is a gate of hope. Come, come, yet again come. Unquote. The message of Rumi, of inclusion, of knowledge, of forgiveness, of compassion, in my assessment, is central to the essence of Islam. And I was further enthralled and delighted when, as soon as I went in the shrine, or in that way, Rumi's grave and graves of many other religious figures are, I saw that in that room, you just look on the top of that hall and you find the names of 12 Imams. And to me, that was very insightful. And that I'll come to that later on as well. Any mosque you go to in Turkey, and this is very different from the Gulf countries, from the Arab countries, from South Asia even. You go to any major shrine or major mosque in Turkey, whether it is Hagia Sophia, it is Blue Mosque in Istanbul or elsewhere, and especially Mevlana Rumi's shrine, you'll find everywhere the names of Imam Hasan alayhi salam on one side, Imam Hussein alayhi salam on the other side. To me, I want to rediscover Rumi to understand what was the central inspiration of his love. And I'll just say one more sentence and I'll come straight directly to my topic. I encourage you to read who was Shah Shams Tabriz and what he taught Rumi that changed Rumi's life. Rumi was a religious scholar, and nothing to say, of course, I'm not saying it in any negative sense. He was a scholar of Sharia, he was a religious scholar, an expert, a teacher. He met Rumi, and the new divine guidance or spiritual elevation that he achieved out of love and compassion allowed him to expand his message beyond a specific certain small group. And that's why I'm making a reference to his message of love. Let me now link this to my discourse today. The topic that I chose, and this whole panel is focused on the status of Shia. What is happening to the Shia in South Asia, in Middle East, and other parts of the world, as we heard from our articulate colleague Lait Kuba about what's happening in the side of Iraq and Bahrain, and I'll focus more on South Asia, which means Pakistan, Afghanistan, and India, and to some extent Iran and Turkey as well, but primarily on Pakistan and Afghanistan. You'll find very clearly that the trends are going in a very negative direction. So I'll explain in my whole discourse in 3 stages. In first stage, I'll explain what is the status of religious harmony, let me put it like that, religious harmony in South Asia today. At the second stage, I'll try to explain what are the historical roots of all that. How do we really understand why are minority groups within Islam and outside Islam, why are they being butchered in that region? What is the core ideology or the thinking of those who are committing these atrocities? Why are they doing it? And how is this whole, these atrocities and human rights violations and barbarity is used also as a resistance to the Arab Spring. And at the third stage, I'll explain what needs to be done for us as Muslims, not only as some of us of South Asian origin, and what to do as American Muslims. So that's how I'll conclude. These will be the three stages. So let me begin by what is the status today. And I'll start with about five major events and five major types of events that are taking place in South Asia to explain what is the pattern. What is the pattern of violence and of these violations? First and foremost, and you know these things, but I want to explain the pattern and the linkage. Attacks on the Sufi shrines in Pakistan. Historically, as many of you would know, Islam was brought to South Asia by the great Sufis. You go to Ajmer in India, you'll find at times as many Hindus as Muslims there. It is because those great Sufis had never forced themselves on others by saying, this is my religious belief and you can come to in my dargah or learn from my teachings only if you become Muslim or become part of a certain tradition within Islam. No, that was never a condition from the Sufis and the great mystics. There were many who differed with that. The Deobandi tradition in Pakistan and India, for instance, had huge issues always with that. But never ever in the history, and that's the point, my first point, never ever in the history of Islam in South Asia of 1,000 years, any shrine was attacked. Now we have seen suicide bombings at the shrine of Data Ganjbakhsh in Lahore, in Rehman Baba in Peshawar, and there are 5 or 6 others. There was also a terrorist attack on Ajmer shrine in India. And it was found out that some people wanted to blame another sect of Islam, which was, they thought only Barelvi Sunnis and Shias go to these shrines. So the purpose was to put the blame on Deobandis. It turned out it was a Hindu fanatic who wanted sectarian and religious conflict in India. But in case of Pakistan, that's one trend. So something has gone terribly wrong. People who believed in going to these shrines for their own demands, for their transcendent elevation, for their spiritual essence, they saw these shrines being destroyed. So that is pattern number one. Second, suicide bombings, which I've hinted at. The number of suicide bombings in South Asia, in Pakistan, Afghanistan, have risen to, if I say, unbearable levels. And even a one suicide attack is unbearable and condemnable. But the numbers, if I mention to you, the range in the last range in, to the to about 500 or so, between 460 and 500 in the last 6 years, on every 60 to 70 suicide bombings. And I was interviewing a police officer from Pakistan recently as part of my research. And they mentioned that the data set is very clear. The number of young people who are involved in suicide bombings mostly are in the age of between 11 to 14. They, in most cases, in 90% of the cases, go to the Waziristan belt between Pakistan and Afghanistan for their training, suicide training centers for these suicide jackets. The total price or the total money that it costs for any terrorist group to have a suicide bomber, you'll be surprised. They mentioned between 18,000 rupees to 20,000, means $200. Because this is what they are taught in terms of their ideology. And I'll encourage you to read actually this by this great book titled American Crescent by Mr. Kazwini, who also mentions about some suicide attacks in Iraq, in Najaf, where those who were arrested before conducting suicide attack, they were crying. And when the police asked them, why are you crying? Because you're scared that police will mishandle you? They said, no, I'm crying because I was about to kill these people in the street in Najaf and you have arrested me, and otherwise I was fasting today, I would have broken my fast with the Prophet of Islam in the heavens. That was the kind of teaching that that person had. It's a question for all of us. Why this distortion or degradation of Islamic scholarship? What has gone wrong that there is a set of so many of these volumes of books which are inspiring people to conduct suicide attacks, whether in South Asia or elsewhere? Mostly in South Asia, unfortunately. Second, that was the second trend. Third trend is attacks in Pakistan, in case of in Sindh province, those of you, I know there are a few people from here from Sindh and they can bear me out, where there are these cases of forced conversions of Hindus, forcefully converting them to Islam, and then coming up with these banners and saying this is the one great thing that they have done by forcefully converting Hindus and Christians to Islam. Somehow or the other, they have been convinced over a period of time that this is what Islam is all about. Irrespective of what you and I say or what Islamic principles say, the reality, that's the third trend. The fourth is these very clearly well-planned, in a very disciplined fashion, executed killings of Shias in Hazara, in Balochistan, which is becoming a big issue, in Kohistan, other areas from where from Pakistani Quetta and Pakistani Balochistan people go to the shrines in Mashhad and in Karbala and Najaf, in buses, those buses are stopped, people's ID cards are checked, and this is not an isolated event. There have been 21 such instances, to be exact, by my quote and my research, in the last five years or so, where people were asked to show their IDs. If your name has a Shah, Hassan or Hussein in it, you are considered eligible to be killed on spot. And this is happening in South. This was not the case historically in South Asia. There were serious issues in the court of Aurangzeb, the great Mughal emperor, who had a kind of a sectarian bias in it, him as well, and there were some issues and wars at that time as well. But historically, within South Asia, there never was this brutal killing of Shias which was entrenched or which was part of the policy of any state. And this is a product of the last 30 years, and I'll come to that, why that happened. But this is important to know, that that targeted killing of Shias and other minorities as well. One other example. And I'll explain later on why it is so critical, not only to look at one's own community, but to look at the level of our principles and support all those who are going through a terrible time in terms of their violations. Increasingly in Pakistan and Afghanistan, if you belong to a minority Ahmadi community, irrespective of what your and mind's theological difference with Ahmadis may be, that's irrelevant to what I'm about to tell you. Keep that aside for a second. They've been told that in major government organizations, they cannot sit during the lunch hour or dinner hour. They cannot sit with Muslims and eat on one table. They have to sit on the side, on a different table, eat in separate utensils. This was Pakistan, which I cannot recognize, and I have lived there for most of my life. And I'm sure many of you cannot as well. Again, I'm making a larger point, this lack of tolerance. So these are the five trends I wanted to mention. The victims of these trends of extremism, you call it bigotry, you call it intolerance, lack of knowledge about religion, whatever name or label we want to give it. These are the five trends which are gaining strength. These are not the predominant patterns, but these patterns slowly and gradually are taking root. So I'll now come to the second stage of my presentation. These were the five trends that are so obvious. Now let's try to understand why all this happened. Why this sudden change in the last 30 years? And there are again about five major issues that I want you to keep in mind to understand what caused it. For scholars and people in academia, the important question is not what has happened. That comes in the newspapers, that comes out in papers as well. Yes, academics do try to find out patterns. But the real question is, on which all these PhDs are granted and all these research grants come, to try to find out what is the cause, what is the correlation, what links to this. And I have five ideas. Excuse me. First, there are many scholars, Western established academics who have proved through their writings, and anyone of you having any doubt or any more questions can come to me later on and I can show you that research, that it is conflict theaters that produces extremism. Wherever there is a conflict, whether that is ethnic, whether that is severely political, whether it is sectarian, whether it is between states, it creates an environment which leads to more extremism and terrorism. That's especially in South Asia. I cannot say that this may necessarily always be true for some other part of the world, but South Asia, this is one can be certain. Conflict theaters, whether it is Kashmir, whether it is the Taliban fight in Afghanistan, whether it is the ethnic confrontation within Pakistan, that provides an environment where these extremists thrive. That's the point number one. Secondly, lack of investment in education. And be very clear, the modern Muslim world, if I may call that, the modern Muslim states are a product of the World War II. Since then, they have been trying to face and adjust to globalization. It is very easy to take a formula, let's say of any, they're leading experts, economic experts here, so I'm careful not to generalize. You can see a very clear model of economic growth, but it is not as easy to just implement it in any developing country. That at times, just copying the models of micro, macroeconomics or the growth designs, you just blindly try to follow those without having those credentials which are necessary for that kind of growth, it creates inequality. It creates injustice. It creates disconnect between different parts of the society. When those differences are to be channelized, are to be expressed, for that, at times you need political ideology. At times, religious ideology becomes very relevant. So that's the second issue, more at a conceptual level. Well, what causes these kind of trends? And you'll very clearly, you can see in Pakistan, Afghanistan, how much is the revenue, how much they produce, what is the disconnect between the haves and the have-nots. So that is also a very important factor. The third point, after conflict theaters and after this lack of investment in education sector, which would have helped this disconnect, which would have created more equality. The third point is geopolitics. Very obvious. Most of us know about it. Whether you call it Iran versus Saudi Arabia in South Asia, or you call that in terms of some of the other Gulf countries, the way they are investing. Someone was mentioning me very recently that in the Gilgit-Baltistan area, which is going through, which is, you can say, a Shia majority area, some of the major areas within Gilgit-Baltistan are, there's a strong rivalry. One of the Arab countries has invested so hugely that you go to those two villages and you'll feel if you're not, maybe you're in heaven or something like that, because they have a completely new infrastructure, scholarships, business investments, and that's the rivalry. It's not just to support Wahhabism or something else. It is knowing fully well that this is an area where the demographics are certain, that the Shias are a majority. Let's challenge that with money. And that's happening. There are other countries involved in that as well. The relevant point is not to name a country. The relevant point is to see that these geopolitical wars are destroying the harmony. This competition, in general sense, competition is normally very positive and creative. But the way this is being framed in South Asia and in Middle East is very destructive of growth and harmony. That was the point number four. And let me just mention two more points quickly and then move on to my conclusions and what I want to suggest. One is about this whole issue of resistance to the Arab Spring. It can very clearly be seen that since the democracy in Iraq, which is establishing itself in a step-by-step fashion, which I think is a great thing, a great model for the other Arab countries, there are others who are very fearful of this new balance of different sects that is taking place. And I don't want to always mention the sects, because sectarian identity in itself should not be our predominant identity. And that, because that extraordinary emphasis on sectarian identity at times becomes problematic as well. But last point in this sense is, why this theological differences have reached a point which are leading to confrontation? Because theological debate is no problem at all. That's how most of the scholarship has come about. But when that difference of opinion and theological debate turns into violence, that is something very, very serious. Why has that happened? And if I may dare say, to raise that question, is it something in the religious seminaries across the Muslim world where the discourse has become very combative? Is that the issue? I don't have the answer. I'm not saying that's the issue. But very clearly, less focus on scholarship and learning and discourse and dialogue and interaction, there is lack of all these things, which is also leading to some of these problems. Now let me come with all these five patterns that I mentioned and the five causes that I think are the most important. There are other causes as well. So where we stand today, I'm sure that you can easily Google and find how many people from minority communities within Islam and outside were killed. That will be no new disclosure. The issue is to understand the cause and do something about it. So what can we do? And I am left with, I think, about 5 to 7 minutes to conclude and explain what can be the agenda, just to raise some ideas for you. And first and foremost, in my assessment, and my humble research tells me, that the central cause behind this kind of conflict and bigotry is saying that I am right. And I am right because I know. And because I know what the truth is, hence that what I know of Islam should be the dominant interpretation. That is the central problem. Just an example, when Einstein was asked what he thinks about knowledge, he said, I know only that I know nothing. You try asking a senior religious cleric in Egypt or Turkey or elsewhere, and they'll tell you, no, I know for sure, definitely, what exactly the principles and essence of religion is in a certain situation. And we will enforce. At times people say jokingly that the modern cleric, mostly in the extremist traditions, I'm very respectful for all the religious scholars here, I'm not giving a sweeping statement, I'm talking about those who support these kind of extremist version. They say, we are sure to go to heaven, but we'll ensure that we take you to heaven as well. And it's their version. That is at the core. So how to challenge that? So on one side, Einstein is saying, I know only that I know nothing. And there's another voice coming from the history as well. Somebody making the case, come to me and ask any question before I am no more among you. And that was Ali ibn Abi Talib. The saying, Ana Madin til ilme wa aliyun babuha, was not without any cause. The central message that the elevation of Ali in terms of his spirituality, in terms of his worldly features, in terms of his intelligence and brilliance, were founded on his knowledge. So anyone who's challenging knowledge, or who's challenging Ali, or who's trying to degrade Ali, anyone who's trying to degrade Ali is in fact scared from the fountain of knowledge which is there. So the enemies of knowledge are the enemies of the Prophet. The enemies of the knowledge are the enemies of God. So the only way you can tackle this challenge of those who say, I know, I have the knowledge, the only way to challenge them is to strengthen, support, expand, expose, propagate, proselytize what you think is the essence of knowledge, and explain to the world who are the knowledgeable, which no one knows more than the community that sits in front of me in my assessment. And even if I say in very objective terms. But the question is that if you want to defeat sectarianism through knowledge, how to go about it? For South Asia, for instance, it is pretty clear. For South Asia, your friends there, or the diaspora, which strengthens and supports many movements in their own countries, whether Pakistan, Afghanistan, or elsewhere, support educational institutions. Support think tanks, support publication houses. If you are American Muslims, which most of you are, then follow the same principles. I want to mention three great efforts which are going on. One, I don't know whether my friend is here or not, Mr. Raza, who with many other Muslims in Hartford area were able to convince Hartford Seminary to establish an Imam Ali chair. They need $1.5 million. Please support them. I know my brother Haider Bahar'ul Ulum is involved in a major effort to establish a major center of learning and research. Please support that if you think you want to make a change. If you don't want to make a difference, then don't crib if you see your community members under distress or being oppressed. Another effort I have seen, another friend who I know, Dr. Ali, who's involved in establishing a medical university here, in a medical college. There are many other ideas, I'm sure, as well. These kind of efforts are very, very critical. But I'll close. One, I wanted to show you another picture of Rumi, because I'll close ultimately with Rumi, the shrine of Rumi. And I was lucky to take a picture because I want to close with that. But before I close, I want to quote from another scholar, Dr. Robert Crane, who's recently published a book, Islam and Muslims in the United States. He co-authored with Mr. Muhammad Ali Chaudhry. And there are two conclusions of the book, a major effort, which they were involved for 5 or 6 years. And this is a message in reference to what we were talking about defeating sectarianism, about ensuring that we really understand what وَاتَسِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا really means. The word tafaraka, sectarian, is so clear. I don't know how after that verse we can even use the word section in any way. Anyway, there are more experts, leading experts sitting here, and they can correct me and explain a better, provide us a better explanation. But I want to quote in closing from Robert Crane's book, and there are two central points. He says, the most insidious threat to every individual person, to a community, and to the global humanity at large is the temptation to abandon one's transcendent purpose in life and instead focus on mere survival, especially through religious tribalism. When a civilization becomes obsessed with maintaining order in order to just survive at the expense of justice and freedom, which are the only lasting sources of order, the civilization dies. And what he says, and what's the conclusion about how Muslims can face this challenge? He says, the challenge to Muslims in America today is how to make common cause with those who are determined to defeat religious extremists in the Muslim world, but those who also think that they must attack Islam as a global religion, referring to the issues of Islamophobia, reference to the issues of stereotyping of Muslims. The challenge is how to educate the detractors of Islam about the sophisticated tradition of Islamic thought so that they can distinguish that the religion Islam from those Muslims who are equally ignorant of it and are against its principles. Effective education about Islam should focus on the paradigm of natural law, which is common to all religious traditions and especially Islam, because this provides empowerment, this provides justice and faith-based reconciliation. I'll again conclude with the couplet that I had started with, because I think this whole message of inclusion, of pluralism, of tolerance of others' views, of ensuring that you will not say that I know and what I know is Islam and what Islam, my Islam is, will be the dominant Islam. To wriggle out of it, to be out of that paradigm, I again leave you with the same couplet, which I'll be honored to recite again, and that will be the end of my discourse. Come, come again. Whatever you are, whether you are an infidel, you are an idolater, or you are a fire worshipper, whether you have broken your vows of repentance 100 times, this is not a caravan of despair. This is a gate of hope. Come, come again. Thank you very much.